going to prove it based on what the U.S. did, but then I will tell on you. I will blow the whistle so everyone knows that you're not doing your job, you're letting the Americans do the job. And then he forced the hand of the Director General to require an evaluation, at least, of how the FDA approved bovine growth hormone. And they found it so ridiculous, so superficial, that it clearly left the health of humans and animals at risk. And because of Dr. Shiv Chopra, you don't have to drink the milk from cows treated with bovine growth hormone. Let's give a hand.
Because taking raw milk from every mother is natural law. How can anybody say we're going to pasteurize milk, we're going to homogenize milk, we're going to make it 2%, 3%, add vitamin D and do this and that? That is all unnatural behavior, unnatural things, adulterated milk, that's not milk anymore. He shouldn't have to do that. We have to sue, take governments to court. Our parliaments we have to sue. It's not an expensive business. If you mobilize, instead of talking inside here every year, we should be on the streets. Mothers should be screaming for natural law. Same thing this afternoon, I'll be talking about vaccines. Immunity is a natural law. And we start injecting foreign proteins which natural law doesn't allow. We shouldn't have to fight the governments. So I think we have to ourselves change our strategy. By saying, label this, don't do that, they're not going to do it. Because they got the power in their hands. So I think the time has come for us, the public, to revert the process. Unless we do that as a massive movement, deoccupy movement, leave my body alone, leave my water alone, leave my milk alone, this is not going to change. Thank you.
Thank you.
In Monsanto's influence in politics is notorious. They were convicted and fined of bribing at least 140 Indonesian officials trying to get their genetically modified cotton to be approved. Let's talk about the Food and Drug Administration in the United States. This is a quote that I think some of our panelists will enjoy hearing. This is from a testimony in 1976 from the former director of the FDA's Bureau of Drugs. No one knew where anything was. There was absenteeism. There was open drunkenness by several employees, which went on for months. There was intimidation internally. People, I'm talking about division directors and their staffs, would engage in the kind of behavior that invited insubordination. People tittered in the corners, throwing spitballs. Now I'm describing physicians. People would slouch down in their chairs and not respond to questions. This is a kind of behavior that I have not seen in any other institution from a grown man. This is the people in charge of our food and drugs, all right? Then it got worse, because in the 80s, it became an atmosphere of approve at all costs under the Reagan administration. So between 76 and 85, more than half of the FDA drug approvals turned out to have lethal or serious side effects, forcing withdrawal or added label warnings. So even with a $500 million current price fees for testing the drugs, they still get it wrong. And with GMOs, as you'll see in a moment, there's no testing. In 2010, 38% of the employees at the FDA agreed that public health has been harmed by agency practices that defer to business interests. One person said, food safety has succumbed to the higher priority of global corporate profits. Lester Crawford, the former commissioner of the FDA, told the dairy industry in a PowerPoint that one of the goals of the FDA is to promote biotechnology. So they're supposed to regulate it and promote it. Lester Crawford left quickly from the FDA and then was convicted and indicted for withholding information and fraud. L-tryptophan, L-tryptophan, a genetically engineered food supplement that killed about 100 Americans and caused 5 to 10,000 to fall sick. The only brand that caused the disease was Showa-Denko. It was genetically engineering the bacteria that produced to produce the tryptophan. But when the FDA testified before Congress about the epidemic, they never mentioned genetic engineering. They blamed it on L-tryptophan in general and took all L-tryptophan off the market because their other goal was to promote the sale of pharmaceuticals. And L-tryptophan was interfering with the sales of what was about to be introduced at the time, Prozac. So they used this genetic engineered epidemic to take all L-tryptophan off the market, but not all of it, because they left it in I think, baby, infant formula, and other, and animal feed. So they weren't really consistently applying their theories, and then later on they lied about what they had known. The FDA declared that GMOs were no different by any significant degree to normal foods. And on that basis, they said no testing was necessary, that companies like Monsanto could determine if its foods are safe. And by this time, Monsanto had already been convicted of lying about the safety of other products. Now, what was actually said at the FDA, because we know this because documents made public from a lawsuit, allowed us to see what was really going on. According to technical experts at the agency, the process of genetic engineering and traditional breeding are different, and they lead to different risks. And yet the policy said the agency is not aware of any information showing that these foods differ in any meaningful uniform way. It was a complete lie, a total fiction. They describe new toxins, higher levels of existing toxins, bioaccumulation of toxins, nutritional problems, possible allergens, new diseases. Dr. Lewis Pribble said there's a profound difference between GM and non-GM. Who overruled them? Michael Taylor, Monsanto's former attorney, was in charge of policy at the FDA. Because the FDA was told to promote biotechnology, so they created a new position for him to run the policy creation at the FDA. He later became Monsanto's vice president, and now he's the U.S. food safety czar at the FDA. Now, when the policy was created by Taylor, it was sent, Commissioner David Kessler sent it to the White House and said, the policy is consistent with the general biotechnology policy, thank you, established by the Office of the President. So we know that it was basically rigged to meet that requirement. But the Office of Management and Budget said, wait a minute, since these techniques are more precise, GMOs, they increase the potential for safe, better characterized, and more predictable foods. So they were suggesting that instead of saying that GMOs were no different, that they were actually safer. And the Assistant Secretary for Health decided to take out the environmental section or reduce it because it raised concerns. So as the policy went up the chain of command in the United States government, GMOs got safer and safer and safer. And that formed the basis for the policy throughout the US government, which is used all over by the Office of the President, USAID, Secretary of State, etc. So the Secretaries of Agriculture in the US have come from the biotech industry. Dan Glickman, Ann Veneman, Tom Vilsack. Tom Vilsack is the current Secretary of Agriculture. He was the Biotech Governor of the Year in Iowa in 2001. He gave Monsanto an award in 2000. Ann Veneman was on the board of Calgene, owned by Monsanto. So this is a picture on the left, which we'll talk about at 4 o'clock, of a new organism that's new to science that appears to be causing widespread infertility and miscarriages among livestock in the United States and widespread diseases to crops. And it was sent in the information was sent in a letter to Secretary Vilsack by Dr. Don Huber, who's a professor emeritus from Purdue University, one of the experts at Roundup, saying the Roundup sprayed on crops appears to be promoting this organism in high numbers, and it's an emergency. It could influence animal health, human health, and plant health. He could tell, he was highly qualified to know that it was an emergency, because he's a colonel in the military and works in a committee to evaluate threats and outbreaks of disease, both natural and man-made. And he was looking at this as an emergency. And yet, when he sent the letter to Secretary Vilsack, It was ignored, and the USDA did not follow up and did not follow his recommendations to not approve Roundup Ready alfalfa, which means that there's now more Roundup going to be poured onto U.S. agricultural land and possibly more proliferation of this dangerous organism. USAID is basically working hand in hand with the biotech industry around the world, U.S. Agency for International Development. Emmy Simmons was a chief executive there. Top executive was debating with a colleague of mine in South Africa when the lights went out. They kept arguing, and at one point she said, in 4 years, enough GE crops will have been planted in South Africa that the pollen will have contaminated the entire continent. So in her anger, she revealed their agenda. Rajiv Shah, formerly with the Gates Foundation, total pro-GM group, he became in charge of USAID. USAID, by the way, wants to work with Monsanto to introduce Monsanto seeds into Nepal. That's news from this week. Nina Fedorov from the State Department, she was a science advisor to two Secretary of States. She is one of the primary pro-GM scientists, and she was deployed in advance of the Secretary of State to different countries to sing the praises of genetic engineering. Jose Fernandez, member of the Obama administration, soon after the Obama administration took office, he gave a talk to the biotech industry organization saying that the government will now act more aggressively against those who are critics of biotechnology. WikiLeaks describes how US ambassadors to various countries have asked Washington to put pressure on Brussels to draw up a retaliation list against certain countries that would, quote, cause some pain. I was in Taiwan 10 days ago giving a press conference at the Congress, and press wanted to know what the WikiLeaks said about Taiwan. And so the US was trying to use Taiwan's open position on GMOs to open the door for GM policy throughout Asia and to gain an ally in the WTO. So they were offering to pay $3,000 each to 5 regulators in Taiwan to bring them to the United States so that Monsanto and the other biotech companies could teach them how to regulate GMOs. So we were exporting not only GMOs, but this hands-off model. The former VP of CropLife, which is the biotech industry's trade commission, became the agricultural trade representative, the person that bullies other countries, saying, if you want to do business with us, you have to accept this, this, and this. So his agenda was obviously pro-GMO. And I'll start, I think we have done with our 10 minutes. So we'll just stop with the US, and we won't take you on a tour around the world, but it's not pretty. So the basic concept is this, that at the national level, in the United States government, we have seen a hijacking, and we've seen it all over the world, certainly in Canada as well. But we're finding now opportunities in state governments, in county governments, in city governments, and in consumer-driven programs, which we'll talk more about in this evening's workshop, what we can do. Thank you.
I think before opening the floor, as I mentioned earlier, we're going to open up the floor at the end of all talks. But for now, if anybody on the panel has a question for Jeffrey, I think it might be interesting to hear what you might have to say. No? Keep going? All right. You'll do this later then. The next speaker will be Dr. Paul Connett. Dr. Paul Connett is a world-renowned expert on the problems with artificial fluoridation in our city water supply. He is the executive director of the Fluoride Action Network and co-author of The Case Against the Fluoride. Welcome to Canada.
Well, I wear two hats on this issue. One hat is the waste hat. And that brings me into the issue of sustainability. We would need 4 planets if everybody consumed like an American, and I assume similar number for Canadians. We'd need 2 planets if everybody consumed like a European. Meanwhile, we have India, China, Indonesia, Brazil, and other huge populations copying our consumption patterns. Something clearly has to change. And in my view, the best place to start that change is with waste management, and I'll talk more about that later. But in the process of this discussion that I've gone through with waste for 27 years, it's very clear in my mind that the world is poised between two separate pressures. One pressure is for the public interest, to do things in the public interest, and the other thing is to do things in the corporate interest. I don't think there'd be much left in on our planet for us. Our lifestyle would be pretty small and miserable compared to what we have today if it's all left to the corporate interest. Making money for making money, no morality, etc. Just consume, consume, consume. There will be nothing left. So really, we have to frame our policies all the time and have to think all the time in the public's interest. And so that brings into the issue of where governments are. Now, as far as politicians are concerned, not many of us trust most of them. Or think hugely of their intelligence. But what about the bureaucrats? What about the civil servants? What about the regulatory officials that are working in the EPA, in the FDA, in the Health Canada, in Environmental Canada?